One of the biggest challenges in animation is how to create the correct feeling of weight. How do you make it so a heavy object or character really feels heavy and strong and forceful? And how do you make something light feel very delicate and elegant? In this video, we're gonna talk about the most important aspects of physics that every animator absolutely has to know. If you are able to animate weight correctly, you have an animation superpower. Your audience, they know how big and heavy characters move. They know how small and light animals move because they have seen it in real life. You need to meet their expectations. If you want to tell your audience that something is light, you need to move it a certain way so that they can believe that. It's pretty cool that we only have to look at reality a little closer to learn what we need to do in our animations. As a first example, I want to show you what happens when I do this finger flick on a piece of paper. The force from the finger flick is enough to make it fly across the table. In contrast, we have a big, heavy book here. And if I flick it with my finger, nothing is happening. I'm not putting enough force onto this book to make it move. So let's put that in some general rules that we can work with. Heavy objects are more resistant. They need more force to start moving. Light objects are less resistant. With only a little bit of force, they can already start moving a lot. So here's a very simplified example of a light object being shoved by this ball. And you see how, you know, the glass has no resistance. It just immediately starts moving with it. In contrast, if you push something heavy, you can see that there is this resistance. Our ball has to really push and then it starts moving really slowly and speeds up. So you see a big difference of how you have to treat moving lighter and moving heavier objects and characters. This is not only true for starting a motion, it's also the case for changing direction or stopping. Let's take, for example, a heavy drone robot. If it wants to change direction, it has to apply a lot of force to catch his weight and move it back into the other direction. In contrast, here we have a light bird. And the bird can just zip around in fast speed, start, stop, and change direction just like that. It's a completely different rhythm of motion. And we can take this a little further. What I did here, after just one or two frames, this light ball is up to full speed again, and it can just lightly bounce around and doesn't have a long period of speeding up and slowing down. In comparison, I have this animation here of what I was imagining could be more like a monkey swinging in the tree. It needs to use anticipations and overshoots because it's swinging back and forth in much more frames. It needs to build up a momentum. It needs to build up a force to push its mass to the next position, and that makes it a lot slower. It's important to note though that heavy characters and heavy objects, they take a lot more effort and force to speed up, but they can be sped up to be really, really fast. But what happens if we stop objects of different mass, of different weight, all of a sudden? Well, I have no problem catching the paper. My hand doesn't even move. I can just, you know, catch it out of the air. But catching the book is a lot more difficult. I have to really work against the mass of the book. I have to go along with it to take the momentum out of it. So as you can see, I need to apply a bigger counterforce to make the book stop. The general rule is that objects would like to stay in the state that they're in unless an unbalanced force is applied. And that's very easy to understand for objects at rest. We just instinctively know that, you know, the book resting on the table, it's gonna stay that way unless I apply a force to it, objects in motion would also like to stay in motion. If we imagine that we are an astronaut and we're throwing a ball, the ball is going to continue flying in that direction until it hits something. On Earth, a ball just rolling on the ground is going to stop eventually because there's the friction of the ground applying a counterforce, taking momentum out of it until it comes to a full stop. So if things would like to continue moving in the direction that they started moving, what does actually happen during an impact? The first thing that I want to point your attention to is that heavy and light objects fall at approximately the same speed. They reach the ground at the same time. There's an exception for if there's air resistance involved. If I would let a piece of paper fall, obviously it will fall slower, but generally, heavy and light things fall at the same speed. They reach the ground at the same time. That might feel a little bit weird to you now because we learned that objects with more mass require more force, and often that means more time to speed them up, right? The reason is that the force of gravity on heavy objects is bigger than on lighter objects. And that kind of compensates for heavy objects being slow to start. So oftentimes when we see things fall, we don't actually get information about the weight, but about the scale and the distance that they're falling. This is the formula for calculating a free fall. We can solve it either towards the distance, d, or the time in seconds, t. This way we can find out that a fall from 1.2 meters or 3.9 feet takes half a second. A fall from 20 meters or 65 feet takes 2 seconds. But there's one moment that gives us all the information about the weight and the material of an element, and that is the impact. Let's have a close look at what happens with this tennis ball and this book when they impact on the table. On the moment of impact, they release the kinetic energy they gained during their fall. The speed is the same for both of them, but because of its larger mass and larger force, the book gained more energy. Energy cannot disappear, it always comes from somewhere and goes to somewhere. Let's assume our ball is made from a fictional, impossibly light and extremely elastic material. Instead of giving off energy to the table, it would just take all of it onto itself and jump up to exactly the same height. It's plus and minus the same amount of energy. But many objects resist to changing their direction like that. Because of their mass and a non-elastic material, they turn a good portion of the energy from the fall into something else. The energy of the book creates mostly deformation and destruction on both the book and the table. If we would let the book fall multiple times, after a while we would see some wear and tear. There's also some motion sideways, and you can see the cover page being lifted up. And then, of course, there's also sound. The book makes a loud bang, and the tennis ball is not really audible. The tennis ball is somewhere between these extremes. Some energy was lost on the table, some went back into the ball to make it jump. This doesn't mean that all light materials bounce. This piece of paper got sent rolling sideways because of its uneven surface. And many light materials like cloth and paper, they lose most of their very little energy because of deformation. So this was the impact with something that can't move, that cannot make way. But here we have two tennis balls that both can move. And when the first tennis ball is rolling into the other one, it splits up the kinetic energy. It keeps a little bit of it and continues rolling, but it also gave a lot of it to the second tennis ball, which is now rolling as well. But of course, we also have the friction of the table, which takes out the momentum until the balls come to a full stop. So applied to character animation, all of this means that light characters are quicker to speed up, slow down, and change direction. They are tossed around very easily by bigger masses. If we have a heavy character, that character is probably slower to speed up, slow down, and change direction. A bigger character is not easily tossed around. Now, especially if you're only starting with animation, it's extremely important that you practice this. So my suggestion would be, if you've never done anything like this before, do these exercise animations that I showed you, these examples, animate them yourself and observe how the resistance works and how the forces go from one object into another object. Really practice that. If you want, we can do some of them together, because I have a premium bonus lesson for you where I walk you through the creation of some of these exercise animations step by step. And we're even going to create this fun character animation with two characters of different weight in OpenTunes. In the free track of this 2D animation course, we're gonna have a look at keyframe animation, which is almost magical because the computer is doing some of the work generating in-betweens that you don't have to draw. However, if you want to support me, I'd be very happy and feel honored if you consider getting the premium tutorial. It will not only help me make more free and paid classes for you to learn animation, but the premium tutorial will also help you to build the skills you need to create animations that make the right impact. In any case, I hope to see you again in one of my classes. I hope you enjoyed it, and thank you very much for watching. Keep on animating.